My name is Brad Frieden. I'm a product marketing engineer with Keysight Technologies. This video is a part of a series of videos looking at how Infinium oscilloscopes can be used to make a variety of RF measurements. We're going to be looking at the S-series oscilloscope. This scope offers 8 gigahertz of bandwidth, and it's been redesigned with a new front end and time base, and combined with amplitude and phase correction on the channel response, these scopes function as an excellent RF receiver for a variety of applications. And we'll look at a digital communications example, wideband communications, today. In this video, we're going to make some basic FFT measurements on a simple input sine wave. And look at some of the details for how to set that up. We're using the S-series oscilloscope with 8 gigahertz bandwidth. This scope has been redesigned from previous generations with a new time base, a new front end, giving it very low close-in phase noise, as well as very linear amplitude response, as well as phase response. All of that results in very high-quality RF measurements. We're using a PSG signal generator to create this 1 gigahertz sine signal. We're bringing it through a very narrow filter. So the signal that I'm going to be bringing over to the oscilloscope is a very pure 1 gigahertz sine. Now I'm going to take the signal generator and adjust the signal up so that I'm right at around 0 dBm coming into the oscilloscope, and we'll start making our measurements from there. After a default setup and an autoscale, we should see a nice sine wave appear, and we do. We'll do a quick measurement here in time and take a look and see that frequency is in fact 1 gigahertz. And I can also make a peak-to-peak measurement on that signal, and 1 milliwatt, 0 dBm, ought to be about 630 millivolts peak-to-peak, and sure enough, it's right there. So we've got some expected measurements to confirm we do have a 1 gigahertz sine wave. Now I'd like to see a spectral view. So from math, spectral, I can bring up an FFT showing me this time domain signal, what I see on screen here, now turned into an FFT for viewing in the frequency domain. Notice I have an axis here from 0 Hz up to 10 gigahertz. The top of the screen is at 2 dBm, a little bigger than the 0 dBm signal that we have. Down here to minus 78 dBm. Notice that the signal is very wide in the frequency domain, even though we know it really is just a single frequency of 1 gigahertz and should be looking like a spike. What we need to do is adjust the resolution bandwidth of the FFT. This defines how wide the frequency buckets are across this axis that our signal is dropping into for display. So if we click on this and start bringing that resolution bandwidth and making it more fine, 200 megahertz, 100 megahertz, 50 megahertz, notice how we're changing time per division and bringing more time capture on screen, which results in more cycles of the sine wave. Notice how this is becoming more narrow. I'm getting a finer resolution and I'm able to distinguish some different things here. And also notice how the noise floor is going to be dropping. Here we are at minus 40, minus 50, so we're just skirting it around minus 50 dBm. As we continue to bring down the resolution bandwidth, here we are now down to 1 megahertz resolution bandwidth. Notice I see a very clear 1 gigahertz spike corresponding to our main signal. I also see some smaller spikes here. There's one at the second harmonic at 2 gigahertz and a third harmonic at 3 gigahertz. So we're seeing that at around minus 50 dBm, that is about our third harmonic distortion level. That's really a lot of nice range there. And then if I check mark peaks, it finds that top peak and tells me that that's at basically 1 gigahertz and right hovering there at 0 dBm. So this is what we would expect for a basic measurement. In many measurements, one wants to zoom in to a frequency of interest and look with a much more narrow span around that point. in this case, we'd like to look right at 1 gigahertz and perhaps look at around 100 megahertz of span around that point and look with a higher resolution. So let's do that. If we look at the FFT controls, I have things like start frequency, stop frequency, center frequency, the span, and we were using resolution bandwidth just a moment ago. Let's change the center frequency from being 5 gigahertz to instead being 1 gigahertz. So now my spike is in the center of screen. Let's change our span. So instead of it being 10 gigahertz, let's make it 100 megahertz. That should really zoom us in here now to this signal. Now, I see width. Looks like I need even more fine resolution bandwidth, but I can do that. Now, I notice that my noise is now down near the bottom of the screen at minus 80. We can change this to 20 dB per decade to give us a little more room on screen of seeing what's happening. And now let's start driving that resolution bandwidth more and more narrow. So we'll go to 500 kilohertz. Now I'm down to 100 kilohertz and 20 kilohertz. Finally, I'll go to 10 kilohertz. Notice how my noise floor has been dropping. I've got that measurement happening on that 1 gigahertz sign, and you can see it really is a pure signal. Even at this close-in view, I'm really just seeing one pixel here of the signal. We've seen how an 8 gigahertz bandwidth S-series oscilloscope was able to make a nice FFT view, a spectral view of the signal. We've also seen how the flat response of the oscilloscope, both in amplitude and phase, and low phase noise, contributed to a measurement like this. And we could have also looked at broadband signals with a wide kind of spectral content. That's the topic of another video. If you'd like more information about what you've seen today and this application of using FFTs, please go to the URL on your screen, and thanks for watching.